Yaso mati nandana bhaja
Thank you.
Srimad-Bhagavatam episode 3, chapter 21, conversations between Maharaja and Candramauli. This is verse number 7. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Personality of Godhead.
The personality of Godhead.
Bhaktya.
In devotional service.
Prapana.
To the surrendered soul.
To the surrendered soul.
Varadasasam.
Varadasasam.
The bestower of all blessings.
The bestower of all blessings.
Vidara speaking, and this is this conversation between him and Maitreya. He's describing something historical. During that period of penance, the sage Kardama, by worships and devotional service to trance, propitiated the personality of Godhead, who is the quick bestower of all blessings upon those who flee to him for protection of the guilt. During that period of penance, the sage Kardama, by worship through devotional service and trance, propitiated the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who is the quick bestower of all blessings on those who flee to him for protection. The significance of meditation is described here. Kardama and Muni practiced mystic yoga meditation for 10,000 years just to please the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Therefore, whether one practices yoga or speculates and does not research to find God, one's efforts must be mixed with devotional service. Without devotion, nothing can be perfect. The target of perfection and realization is the Supreme Personality of God. In the sixth chapter of Bhagavad Gita, it is clearly said that one who constantly engages in Krishna consciousness is the topmost yogi. Yoginam Mapisangi Visham. Shravam Bhajate Yoga. So that's the last verse in the Bhagavad Gita in the sixth chapter, where Krishna is describing the whole yoga process in very detail. Goes through the different yogas, especially Astanga Yoga, which is the eightfold mystic process of yoga. But then he ends that actually he who engages in devotional service, abiding me, is the highest and topmost of all yoga. So after describing the different yoga, it's called yoga ladder, different stages of the yoga process, the utmost yoga is bhakti yoga. And that will be explained. Then it goes on here. One who has surrendered unto the lotus feet of the Personality of Godhead, Hari or Krishna, in order to achieve real success, one has to surrender to the Lord in order to achieve. What is real success? That success that fulfills all of one's desires. So, in other words, fulfillment of desires means makes one perfectly happy. What is the real desire? Real desire is to exchange love, or to have the perfect relationship. Now, in this world, we look for that relationship in friends, family members, people in general, but it can be found only in Krishna. And when we have that relationship with Krishna, all our desires, in other words, there's nothing left to achieve. Because it's completely. So here it says, only by devotional service, by surrendering to Krishna, one can achieve real success. There's four types of success that are considered success, but they don't give satisfaction, so in one sense, they're not successful. Or if you achieve something material, it may give you some temporary satisfaction, but in due course of time, what happens? You lose it, it changes. So whatever success you may attain, you may find some satisfaction. Time takes us away. That's just the nature of the material world. But in Krishna consciousness, there's no effect of time. Whatever relationship we establish with the Lord can only grow as long as we work to make that grow. In other words, as long as we continue to engage in emotional service. Okay. Okay. Devotional service of engagement in Krishna consciousness is the direct method. So there's other ways. There's more or less direct methods through various types of meditations, austerities, rituals, various types of yoga processes. These things can elevate one's consciousness, the karma yoga, performing activities and giving the results to Krishna, some of the results, keeping some for yourself. Or jnana yoga, detaching oneself from all material activities. All of these can elevate one away from the material suffering, but they can't give complete success. Only when one comes to bhakti is success achieved. Why? Because that's the nature of soul. So it is by nature, nityasiddha, Krishna prema, sarvakamuloy, sravanadisiddhi chitte, kori e guloy, in the hearts of all living entities, pure love for Krishna exists. So to love Krishna is natural, and to attain that loving relationship is the perfection of life. Anything less will leave one unsatisfied. Although one may feel a little better from being free from the encumbrances of material energy, still, until one reaches that loving relationship with Krishna, one cannot be completely satisfied. One will consider himself something still is missing. And that's that loving relationship with Krishna. And that's devotional service. Okay. As Prabhupada goes on, all other methods, although recommended, we mentioned them, are indirect. In this age of Kali, the direct method is especially more feasible than the indirect method because people are short-living, their intelligence is poor, and they are poverty-stricken and embarrassed by so many visible disturbances. Don't look at the newspapers because they'll tell you the same thing. It's just one calamity after another, one fall out of. Everyone is struggling hard to find some happiness and achievements and peace in life, but they get the opposite. So you might think, well, what's wrong? Are we doing it wrong? Maybe we just have to do it another time and get it sooner or later. But that's the materialism. The more you play with the material energy to make it better, the more you suffer. The more you try to control the material energy, the more you become controlled by that energy. Maya Narasimha Prabhupada, Sujitaya Sanchara, Krishna is the only control of the material energy. No one can control the material energy, only the Supreme Lord. But one who takes shelter of Krishna, that energy also becomes a support in their relationship with Krishna. In other words, the material energy automatically becomes controlled by Krishna for one who takes shelter of Krishna. So the materialist is just working hard, struggling, arranging so many things in so many different ways, the money to get, more problems, and so on. More problems. Why? Because it doesn't work. Because you try to put a round peg into a square hole, it just doesn't work. It just doesn't work. They're trying to achieve success by something that doesn't work. Only when it comes to devotional service can one find fulfillment. Otherwise, it's always less or even none. So Prabhupada said, to be embarrassed by so many miserable disturbances. It's like on 4th of July this year, there were three shootings in three different places in America. People were just randomly killed for no reason. Crazy people. People are crazy, completely nuts. This is what happens when material life extends itself so much that it becomes so insane that it doesn't make any sense anymore. People go crazy. That's the extent of trying to enjoy this material world. You become mad, actually, after a while. You either become self-destructive or you become outwardly destructive towards others, or both. So here, he continues, Lord Chaitanya therefore has given the greatest poem. In this age, one simply has to chant the holy name of God to attain perfection in spiritual life. There it is. The word Sampapede means that in various ways, Candramauli is satisfied the Supreme Personality of Godhead by his devotional service. So devotional service is the way to satisfy Krishna. Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, only by devotional service can I know as I am standing before you, and only in this way can you enter into my mind, mysteries of my understanding. Only this way can you know me. There's no other way to know Krishna, only by devotional service. All other processes can come, as I mentioned, to a certain level of betterment, but they can't give you that knowledge. Krishna is not, he's not Jnana Vatsal, he's not Yoga Vatsal, he's not Karma Vatsal, he's Bhakta Vatsal. He's captured only by love. Are you tired? No. Are you tired? You're sleeping? No. Okay, you meditate. Really interesting way of meditating. You awake? Okay, huh? Look like you were, you know, waking up for last night. We're trying not to fall asleep. If you get tired, somehow or other, stand up or chop up and down. Take a bath. Please stay awake. The devotional service is also expressed by the word Kriya Yoga. Candramauli not only meditated, but also engaged in devotional service. To attain perfection in yoga process or meditation, one must act in devotional service, Shravanam, Kirtanam, Smaranam. Remembering is meditation also. Actually, remembering is the combination of meditation. When we remember Krishna, then that's the perfection of hearing, that is the perfection of our chanting when we do remember Krishna. But who is to be remembered? One should remember the Supreme Personality of God. Not only one must remember the Supreme Person, one must hear about the activities of the Lord and chant his glories. So we say, well, chanting Hare Krishna Mahamantra is the essence. But still, in order to support the quality of our chanting, we need to also practice the whole process of Bhagavad. We should glorify the Lord in different ways. We should worship the Lord in different ways. And we should also perform the activities as given by the spiritual master. In other words, the rules and regulations and come with the process. All of these give support and require in order to qualify or to increase the quality of our chanting, increase the enthusiasm for chanting. They're supportive. But once one perfects their chanting, then all other processes are not necessary. One comes to the stage of pure chanting, a sudanam. This information is in the authoritative scriptures, so usually you find all the information. How do you glorify the Lord? After engaging himself for 10,000 years in performing different types of emotional service, Candramauli attained the perfection of meditation. But that is not possible in this age of Kali. It is very difficult to live as much as 100 years. So previous ages, people lived longer. In this age, it's Manda, Sumanda, Mandayo, Mandiyabhava, and in this age, it's not, people are short-lived. In this age, four things are decreased. Memory is decreased. Longevity of life is decreased. Mercifulness is decreased. And bodily strength is decreased significantly in the age of Kali. So people are not as strong as they used to be. Their memories are short. Now knowing the people with this disease called Alzheimer's, can't remember who we are. It's even a disease of a lack of memory. Becomes so bad it turns into a disease. What else in this age? Mercifulness. Killing of animals randomly, killing of children randomly, killing of each other. Mercy has gone out the door. And memory. Memory. And what else did we say?
Strength.
Bodily strength, yeah. Strength and longevity of life. People don't live so long. I think Prabhupada was saying that the average age, this was many years ago in India, people, the average age was 39 years old. The average duration of life. That was years ago. I don't know what it is now. But people don't live long. And as Kali Yuga increases, the duration of life will be continually reduced. Or at the end of Kali Yuga, it says that if one lives 20, 25 years, they will consider to be a grand old man. 20, 25 years. That's how bad this age is. But Kalir Dosha Vidi Raja, Astiyano Mahamu, Kirtanai of Krishna, Sana Mukta Sangam Padamaja. Now, this is not a small statement. There's one very powerful, bright light in this age, and that's Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has delivered the mercy to elevate and to push back the effects of poverty that has accepted the Hare Krishna Mahaprabhu. Very powerful and very concluded. But as we mentioned, we should also glorify the Lord in different ways. We should associate with devotees. We should also take Krishna Prasad. We should also worship the Lord in his deity form. All of these things are necessary to come to the stage of perfection. These are like additions, supporters. But then when you reach perfect chanting, then there's nothing else but the chant. I was just in Birmingham, the UK, just a couple of weeks ago. And I was talking to one lady, she was there. And she had been chanting 32 rounds a day for years. Now she came up to me and she said, Maharaj, I'm chanting now 64 rounds a day. So I said, can you do it? She said, I love it. She said, now I understand everything's a normal thing. He came to the realization through this increased job that everything is in the world. And she was crying when she was saying this. She understood by her own experience that the whole thing is up. But we shouldn't artificially try to do that unless we can actually come to that stage naturally through the process of bhakti. In other words, we can increase our rounds exponentially, regularly. We should also associate with devotees on the regular. And then as the chanting continues, then that becomes your only sadhana. And you just chant that chant. I think Yugala was telling me just yesterday that Srila Haridas Thakur is a disappearance that you chant 192 rounds. That's nice. Then you start to understand. I've been trying to figure out this Bhakti Yoga, but now I got it. It's all in the whole thing. Really. That verse, Kalir Dosha Nidhi Raja, Asti Echo. Asti means one. There is one. Echo means one. What is that? Maharuna. That benediction that is the best of all benediction. And the first line, Kalir Dosha Vidi Raja. We're in the middle of this ocean of material stuff. And Kali Yuga is a deep ocean. So many problems. And it's going to get the problem. I said, don't stay around. It's going to get worse. Especially next year. Watch out. The end of this year is going to be out. But anyway, that's another one. And so this is Kali Yuga. It's just the way it is. You might say, well, why is it like that? It's like saying, why is it cold in the winter? Because it's winter. It's like that because this is the age of, you know, quarrel, hypocrisy, the age of sense gratification and economic gain. People are only interested in people. To get more material things and money and how to enjoy the senses. That's it. Everything else, they do centers around that. But that's not life. Life is, you know, atatu brahma jigyasa. That's really life. Find out who you are and how to realize yourself in loving service of the Supreme Lord. Okay, so unfortunately, people in this age, especially persons who are demonic, wanted to be cheated. Thus, the Supreme Personality of Godhead sends great cheaters who mislead people in the name of yoga and render their lives useless and doomed. Krishna supplies these bogey yogis. I remember I was in Vrindavan, and there was an announcement. Kalki Avatar is now in Pittsburgh. Really, he had a beard, and his jailers, his followers came with dirt. You know, they came to the Vrindavan with all kinds of flyers, pictures. He made it. I said, "Well, he's a little early." But they didn't have an incredible understanding of that. They couldn't handle that. So they were inviting the boys to go meet, you know, Kalki Avatar. But I was thinking, we don't want to go meet Kalki Avatar, he's for the demons, not for us. But anyway, this is what goes on. There's so many bogey yogis, you know, nowadays. So, I mean, Prabhupada said, every day, some incarnation of the Supreme Lord appears from India into America. What does he do? You take this mantra and you chant the mantra and give me money. And then you will get down. So yeah, he already has this mantra, that mantra. Om Namo. A worship guru, guru is the epitome of, you know, everything. Guru come, guru ji, guru come, guru. Guru is everywhere. Where's Krishna? Doesn't matter. Guru. And guru is riding his Rolls Royce with his girlfriend. I was in New Orleans one time, and Jesus Christ appeared there. he claimed to be Lord Jesus Christ. So we didn't pay attention to him. And then after some time, we decided to leave. We didn't give him the attention he was expecting. And so I was driving my vehicle, van, and then he was hitchhiking along the road when I was driving. So I thought, man, give Christ a ride. So he stopped my car. And he got in. And then I started talking to him. I said, You're Lord Jesus Christ? He said, yes. I said, well, it says in the scriptures that he has the stigmata, which is the marks of crucifixion on his hands. And let me see your marks of crucifixion. So he went like this. I said, I didn't see anything. He said, let me show him once. So I thought, since he's Christ, he's used to austerity, so I decided to ask him to leave the car. He said, it'd be better if he walks. And so this is what goes on. And the statistic was, this was in 1980. And that there were 2,500 persons who claimed to be Jesus Christ. Only 2,500. Not that many. The people, I don't know, whatever, you know, if you can't enjoy this world, you just be God and you get some kind of worship. So this goes on in the name of religion. And there's so many of them. I can tell you more stories, but I don't think you want to hear. Okay, so continue. In the Bhagavad Gita, therefore, it's clearly stated in the 16th chapter, 17th verse, that rascals who are self-made authority and being puffed up by illegally collecting money perform yoga without following the authority of the books. They are very proud of the money they have plundered from innocent people who want to be cheated. So that is also an important point. People don't want the real things. That's why bhakti yoga is rare. To attain bhakti is rare because what is the attainment? One can purchase Krishna, the supreme personality of God. In other words, one can control Krishna. There are three things. There's bhakti, bhakta, and bhagavan. Bhakti is the process of pure devotional service. Bhakta is the devotee. Bhagavan is the supreme personality of God. And Bhagavan is controlled by bhakti. And when Bhakta has bhakti, he can control Krishna. Krishna is controlled by love. Anyone who loves you can control you by that love, because that love is the kind of control that is sweet and wonderful. When love is there, we accept that control. But Krishna is the same. He likes to be controlled. But only love can do that. So even though his mother chastises him, he loves him because she does it out of love. His counter friends, they jump on his back, they wrestle, they take his love pill away, and they say, you're not so good, great. But he likes that because it's all done out of love. So love is what controls Krishna. So here, to attain the process of perfection of yoga, so the process is very easy. Shravanam, Kirtanam, Krishna Smaranam. This is the process. To hear and chant the glories of love. Because Krishna is all attractive. And the more we hear his glories, the more we absorb ourselves in chanting his holy name, the more the soul becomes awakened to that natural love. So that's the process of devotional service. We have to hear and chant. The devotee says, well, I'm doing that, but we don't do it enough. That's the problem. We don't do it enough. And we have to do it more and more. And as we do it more, the quality of the activity starts to increase. Quantity helps to bring about quality. So when we get a taste, ruchi, then we want to hear more about Krishna, just like Maharaj Parikshit. He heard from Sukadeva Goswami for 7 days the glories of the Lord. He completely forgot about eating, sleeping, and any of the bodily needs. He simply absorbed himself in hearing and also asking questions. And Sukadeva Goswami was so inspired that he also absorbed himself in the process of chanting. And at one point, after 6 days of narrations, Sukadeva Goswami said to Maharaj Parikshit, do you want a break? Do you want some water? And Maharaj Parikshit immediately answered, no, this is what I'm waiting for. He had finished 9 cantos. He's about to begin the 10th. Now, this is why I'm dying. And we're waiting to hear Krishna's pastime. So when Sukadeva Goswami heard the response from Maharaj, he became more enthusiastic. So this is also an important part of devotional service, that the more you're eager to hear, the more the person is eager to speak. It automatically happens. And of course, if the person is eager to speak, that also increases your eager to hear. But the hearing is more powerful than the speaking, because it brings about the speaking from them. So when we're eager to hear about Krishna, we have this unlimited knowledge will come our way. Unlimited. And then we get so absorbed in hearing and chanting the glories of the Lord, and then your material life is finished. Sorry. Oh no, we won't do that. Oh God. That's a problem, right? Krishna, not too much Krishna, just enough. But the emotional service works that the more you go for it, the sweeter it is, the more you want more and more and more. Well, of course, Krishna is not trying to destroy our material life. He's trying to destroy material consciousness. So we can carry out our material affairs in the devotional consciousness. Bhaktivinoda Thakura gives an example. Manaso deho geho yukhiji muharpi lutu avadi nandakishwara. My nandakishwara, my home, my wife, my family, my goodness, my possession, everything, it all belongs to you. So that's then Bhaktivinoda Thakur is the ideal household. He had 10 children, and he was a magistrate, British Raj, very highly respected within that service. He was given much acclaim by the British, and he did his service so nicely and expertly. He was absorbed in writing books and preaching Krishna consciousness. He wrote over 100 books, periodicals, and articles on Krishna consciousness. And he maintained his family nicely. Although he didn't give them a lot of time, he gave them enough time where they were completely satisfied. And they were also devotees of the Lord, especially his fifth son. That was Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati. And the seventh son, or third son, was Lalit Prashad, who was also a great devotee. We don't hear too much about him, the brother of Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati. He was practically on the same level as his brother, but he was more of a recluse and was not so much preaching or out there. He was mostly doing his own budget. So yeah, so here's an example of how devotional service can be executed in any of the ashrams, brahmacharis and sannyasa. So as long as we understand, keep Krishna foremost and keep the chanting of the holy name, the most important part of our daily activity. And then that will open up desire to hear about Krishna more, to serve Krishna more, everything centers around. Some of us like to serve, some of us like to chant, read more. And that's individual. But in both cases, we all have to hear the chant the glories. Because that awakens the soul's attraction to Krishna. Krishna is all attractive. And everything about Krishna is attractive. Nama, Rupa, Rupa, Viva, all of those activities about Krishna are the most attractive, especially Viva. There's one story where Krishna's in Vrindavan. He had just killed a demon. And his friends all ran around the Mahavakana. And he said, "Wow, Krishna, how did you do that? That was a big demon. Yesterday I beat you in wrestling. Kill that." And Krishna remained silent. So then they all start guessing. Wow. One of them said, "It's his mother. She gives him these armlets and amulets. She ties them on her arm. It's got mantras inside. He's a power." And that's how he kills them. In other words, yeah, it's his mother, but then she teaches him the mantras. So he has these demon killing mantras. So they're guessing back and forth. They can't get it. So finally, Krishna says, you want to know? Yeah. Don't get around Krishna to find out what's going on. Krishna said, well, when I was born, my father was visited by this very powerful sage. And he came to a private meeting to speak to my father. Nobody knew about it. And he said to my father in secret, no, your son, he is as good as an Arahant. In fact, he is an Arahant. So then Krishna turns to his friends. So you want to know? I'm God. And they're looking at each other and they're laughing. He's God. I mean, they're laughing and laughing. Yesterday I stole your lunch and you were crying. And so they're laughing and laughing, and Krishna's laughing, and then they just keep laughing and laughing and laughing. And finally Krishna said, let's go fly out. And the place where that pastime happened is called Hashiran. Hashya means laughter. So when you go there, of course, when you hear this pastime, what happens is you laugh. It's just laughter. I was reading it, and I was thinking, after I finished reading it, I was laughing so much I had to put the book down. I couldn't read it. So yeah, it's Krishna's pastimes are so sweet. It's so wonderful, and they're all filled with great transcendental messages that we can learn from. Brahmi's leaders also, they're also destructive. Krishna performs pastimes, which give us also transcendental knowledge along with transcendental happiness. That's Krishna. Okay, so these are something. And then back to the essence again. There's one verse in the second canto, first chapter. And it's simply by hearing, chanting, and remembering the Supreme Personality of Godhead, one can attain perfection at the end of life. Antanamayanam smriti. And the perfection of life is about hearing, chanting, and remembering the Supreme Personality. And the more we develop our hearing and chanting, the more we become attracted to Krishna. And as the attraction increases, then we become attached to Krishna. We want more and more and more. And then when that attachment becomes so strong, it takes you out of the tomb. Krishna says, oh, hurry. Now you're ready. Come back. I'm waiting for you. So this is the process. So try to hear and chant the voice of the Lord as much as possible. Satam prasangam brahmavirya samvidam bhavati ritkana rasayana kata. Rasayana kata means that rasa, sweet nectar, that kata, which is ritkana, rit is the heart, karna is the ear. It's nectar to the ear, to the heart. And then that verse goes on, and then bhakti really begins. Real bhakti begins when we develop a taste for hearing and chanting the voice of the Lord. But how is that done? Sri 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 Ashadadamasya, Vasudeva Katamuji, Shadiyana Srikam, Odissu Shavan, Kirtan. Sri 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 Ashadadamasya, Vasudeva Katamuji, by rendering service to great souls, great service is done. By such service, one gets an affinity, attraction, attachment to hear glories of the Lord. So that's where it begins when we serve the devotees. We get a chant, we get a taste, we get an attraction, we get an awakening for one to hear and chant. And then when that develops, then the modes of passion and ignorance come. And one is situated in goodness, and one becomes happy. That's the process. Okay, so any questions, comments? Yes, ma'am.
My first question is as you have been repeating again that to support chanting we need to glorify the Lord through prayers. So as people like us who are getting more busy in our material world, what is the one prayer that you would recommend us to do?
As we're becoming more and more involved in taking care of material business, what is that powerful prayer? Krishna, save me. That's it. No. Save me. Bring me back to your lotus feet. Krishna, here's your prayer. The sincerity of the prayer is the power of that. The more you're sincere, the more power that prayer has. But this is not actually a prayer, but it's a mood. And this is explained by Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu himself, where he says that living in the material world and taking care of material duties, he gives an analogy or an example. A wife has a husband. But she also has a lover. Now, she doesn't want her husband to suspect her relationship with her lover. So she does her duty nicely to her husband. But in her heart and in her mind, she's always thinking, when will I go and be my lover? She meditates on him, but she still does her external duties nicely, so nothing is a suspect. So Mahaprabhu was saying that we do our material duties, but we keep our heart in Krishna. And we're always thinking, when can I be with the devotees? When can I go to the temple and worship the Lord? When can I chant the holy names? So that's that eagerness that comes. It becomes the focus. And the duties are carried out, but they're carried out more like routine. We don't get so attached to our material beings. We just do them because it's necessary. Yes. Is that okay?
Thank you.
Yeah.
So once you are able to chant Shutanam, then it is the perfect stage.
And there's no other service. And that becomes the only service.
Yeah. So, but how can we reach to that stage?
Wow. There's Namaparama, there's Namabhas, and there's Sudanam. So, avoiding the 10 offenses and chanting the holy names in the morning. So, and Bhakti Vinodta, of course, said, especially when she concentrate on the 11th offense, attempted chanting. He says, by developing attempted chanting, you minimize the tendency to commit any of the other offenses. It becomes less likely. So, attempted chanting is really the focus. I really try to chant with as much devotion and as much attention as you can. And that you have to work at that. Chantamana Bhuvana Krishna Pramati Bhagavan, mind rests in the world. Bring it back to the sound. Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, whatever, wherever the mind wanders, bring it back under the control of the sound. So the mind is flickering. And when Arjuna presented that to Krishna, he said, Chancellor in Krishna Pavati Bhagavadha. Thus you have been one day by now seduce Karam. Krishna said, yeah, you're right. It is restless, it is unsteady, it is difficult to control. And Arjuna said it's like trying to control the moon. But Krishna said, Abhyasena to Kunti na Vairagina to breathe. Practice. Practice and but at the same time give up your desire to enjoy material. Because if you're still trying to enjoy material life, practice Krishna consciousness. The process is very, 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 very small. Really slow. In fact, there's no goal. We have to come to the understanding that there's nothing in the material world can give me happiness and satisfaction. Only emotional satisfaction. Even if we still are attached to material things, at least we should be theoretically understand this principle that there's no happiness in the material. Then when you practice the tenth of chanting, you'll make progress.
You said one desire to hear the glories of Krishna, one has to serve devotees.
One has to
serve the devotees. Serve the
Lord. Yeah, we have to Vaishnava Seva is the essence of practice of bhakti. It leads to Namaruchi.
You mean to say that once you serve devotees in nature?
Well, this verse was spoken by Sutta Goswami. And he's responding to the questions in Navishvaranya. And he's indicating the pure devotee in this verse. But Prabhupada expands that point in saying all devotees. Once you take out the opportunity to serve whatever we can and look for opportunities to serve. Because the whole process of bhakti centers around service. Hearing is service, chanting is service, everything is service. But when that service is directed towards serving Krishna by serving the devotees, that is the best service. Krishna says in the Adi Purana, one who says he's my devotee is not my devotee. The one who says he's a devotee of my devotee is actually my devotee. But Krishna gives the formula that if you want to actually serve me, the best way to serve me is to serve those who are serving me. Koki bhatta bhatta become our Lord. Das, das, hundred das. But if you think, well, how do you know who's pure and who's not? Well, you know, a person's position is not necessarily indicative of their purity. They could be persons who are just wandering pot washers, not being pure, pure devotees. You don't know. So don't take any chances, sir. We don't really know. But position does give some indication, but it's not necessarily the criteria for understanding. How can you understand an advanced devotee? One has a nice time. There's always a major devotion of service. That's an advanced devotee. And you can see that on any level.
Thank you so much. I have a question connecting to what Prabhupada once said. Serving the devotees, community, and initiate that, because you concluded that that's the way our process starts. When we set kickstart and increasing taste for spiritual life, you mentioned that. So, my question is what is the attitude one must have when one begins the process, of course, one matures in bhakti, then he has ruchi in service. So he enjoys that seva. Because his conditioned, he's settled in that nature. But then one begins this in this context, I need to ask certain devotees.
What is the mood itself?
Yeah, what should be the mood to kickstart? You know, in the sense, what should be helplessness, or should be, I need this. I mean, that's where I'm thinking, but I want to confirm.
Well, there's different stages. You know, Bhakti Vinodha Kaur has four stages that are motivations for service. And each stage is progressive. The first stage is the lowest. He said, I'm serving because if I don't serve, then I'll get smashed. I'll suffer if I don't serve. In other words, have a fear. And you see many religious organizations that push that. God is going to, you know, make your life miserable if you don't serve. So that's the fear, but that's for children. We use that. For grown-ups, it doesn't necessarily work, but still, it's a motivation. I'm serving because if I don't serve, I'll suffer. And higher than that is, I serve because it makes me happy. So, and that's not stable either, because if you see, you've given some service to, I don't like the service, it's not going to make me happy. You know, I won't do it. So, no, that's not stable either. So then the third stage is the higher stage, is serving and duty. It's my duty to serve. And the fourth stage is perfection, serving out of love. Bhakti Vinod Thakur mentions these four and he explains the characteristics of each one of them. So to be situated nicely is to be situated on the third stage, duty. We can't get away from service. It's our nature. If we're not serving Krishna or the devotees, we're serving in the material life. People are serving each other, they're serving their boss, they're serving their family members, they're serving their friends, they're serving their dog. They serve in the mind. Everybody is serving someone. So that's the mood. It's my duty.
Hi, John. Thank you for this wonderful interview with us. As we mentioned about this hearing, chanting, and remembering. So one part is that they hearing and chanting, and then there's the perform statement that they, when this remembering is there, that is the perfection.
The whole thing is Krishna is always the
perfect. So Maharasam, in cases like when we will be hearing, but many times there will be, because of the notion of Kali Yuga and because of the ignorance which resides, so sometimes we are not remember everything.
We practice. The process of bhakti is just practice. Practice developing the hearing, practice developing your chanting, and then gradually it will lead to smarta. Smarnam has five stages, as mentioned. Different, each one is more intensified. And the highest stage is samadhi. But if you want to increase your smarnam, increase your kirtan. If you're simply hearing, that's nice. And if you hear it properly, it will lead to chanting. The chanting means, just like there's a statistic in the material world. Well, this was about, they say that people will remember 10% of what they hear. They remember 20% of what they read. 10% of what they read, 20% of what they hear, 30% of what they read, 20-30% of what they see and hear together, 50% of what you do, and 90% of what you teach. So we want to remember, repeat it. That's fine. The more you repeat it, the teachers, they have to remember because they have to repeat it. So that's good for them. And memory becomes stronger when you speak what you know. And then recall becomes more easier. It's just the way the mind works. And that's why we say, you know, talk about Krishna. Or find ways to speak about Krishna. Or emotions.
Thank you.
Please accept my greatest blessing and always from this
tradition.
Maharaj, how to come out of his desire to impress others through devotional service?
That's what I'm working on. Let me know if you get the phone, but I'm still trying to work on it. Oh, God. How to pray? Just try to please Krishna. Try to please your spiritual master. That's the focus. This is subtle sex desire. It's called profit, adoration, and distinction. Wanting to get some attention for who you are or what you are. Wanting to get some praise for what you do. Wanting to be known in different ways. It's subtle sex desire. But it's there. And so, to glorify, therefore, the best way is to glorify the Lord, glorify the spiritual master. So we say, all glory is to Srila Prabhupada. All glory is to my spiritual master. All glory is to the assembly of the Lord. We pass it on. If you keep it, then it becomes a feature of your consciousness. Let's pass it on. And if you are eager to get it, and you don't get it, you feel something's missing. And if you are used to getting it, and you don't get it, then you think, what happened? All these people understand why. You think like that. So it's just part of the material, the subtle forms of material design. How to get over that? Just glorify the Lord, glorify the devotees. Turn it around. What you want about yourself, give it to others.
It's very profound, very realized. So internally, whenever anything happens in that sense, so, how to make the voice of the heart so strong that the mind doesn't resist? So,
it's almost tell the mind to shut up. He's a rascal. He's in his trouble. Keep quiet. You know, your little child is running up to you, trying to get your attention, you're trying to do your housework. After some time, you just ignore him and he goes away. If you give attention to these things, they increase. Just ignore it. and replace it with something spiritual. Yeah, the mind is, you know, Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati says your mind is a non-devotee. So I'm not supposed to associate with that. So you have to convert that guy into a devotee. No?
Who is that devotee?
That's
the outside devotee, sir. Indian is a devotee.
I'm not sure I understand.
So when the mind is a non-devotee,
yeah.
Exactly, is also
well, you have to use your intelligence by connecting your intelligence to Shastra, connecting your intelligence to Guru. So the words of the spiritual master, the words of Krishna coming through Shastra, is the way to convert that mind into a devotee. If you find your mind wanting to criticize someone, then just start thinking about the good qualities rather than criticize or praise you. If you feel angry towards someone, then practice forgiveness. What is an antidote for evil? Yeah, how about on the ladies' side?
I have two questions. My first question is an extension of what Shanti Shukla had asked. As you were mentioning about praise, is there a difference between praise and appreciation? Because there is, especially with, for me, this is more personal for me, because when it comes to kids or in the house, I feel I want to be appreciated. I don't want to be praised, but I want to understand, is there a difference? And
Well, the children have to appreciate their parents. So there's a little demand in that direction because it's good for the children. It's not that you want appreciation, but they have to do that. Otherwise, you know, how will they grow properly? How will they develop the right relationships with the parents? They have to appreciate the parents, they have to appreciate what their parents have given them, especially. That's not wrong, but if you try to force them, it may not work. You have to do it in such a way that they can accept it. And that, you know, have to do it by learning. You know your child, so you know what works.
My next question is about there was a sentence which says, persons who are demonic in nature want to be cheated. I was under the impression that, if someone gets cheated, it's because of ignorance or innocence. How is ignorance and innocence considered demonic? Or is there any other quality that is
innocence demonic? And ignorance. Innocence is not demonic. Innocence is just... innocence has a broader definition. Innocence means we could be unaware of the situation. More like a sense of unawareness. Or it may also be certain characteristic. People have certain qualities, character, personal qualities. Person could be more innocent, less delicious, less manipulative. Innocence is not a bad quality, but a lot of times innocence can be taken advantage of by other people, and they can exploit innocent people. So we should have that knowledge too, so we don't get taken advantage of. Yeah, so when people are innocent, they're also open for exploitation by others who are of that nature. Well, but ultimately, innocence is nothing wrong with it. The innocence of a child is very attractive. Even if a person is innocent, they're also very attractive. But they can also sometimes we take advantage of. An innocent person may also be a trusted person, and they may trust the wrong people and be cheated because of that.
So what is Prabhupada trying to convey when he says that persons with demonic nature, what qualities is he trying to?
Says, unfortunately, people in this age, especially persons who are demoniac in nature, want to be cheated. In other words, they don't want the real thing. They want something material, they want something less. They don't want bhakti, they may want God, but they may want God as a person who supplies all of their material desires. He didn't say people who are demoniac, he said people who want demoniac nature. Otherwise, it's something that is there. You know, they have the wrong attitude about life. Their attitude is to want to enjoy, their attitude is more than that, want to exploit. That's their nature. That's a demoniac nature. They want to cheat. They want to get something for nothing. They want to take advantage of every situation for their personal interest. So therefore, he says that, and then Prabhupada goes on, we have to read the next sentence. Thus the Supreme Personality sends great cheaters who mislead them in the name of yoga. So they don't want the real thing. They want some yogi to tell them that you can enjoy material life and be religious at the same time, spiritual at the same time. Which goes, it's quite common nowadays. It's like when devotees join the movement. You know, his parents were saying, you're depriving him of all the natural things in life. No, this is sex, no intoxication. No gambling. This is life. All right, let us worship God, but these things should go on also. And see, this is how people think in this life. They don't know what's real spiritual.
Maharaj, these exercises are most respectful. Thank you so much, Maharaj, for this wonderful class and personal association to us. My question is, you mentioned surrender in the class. So Maharaj, my question is about surrender. I really want to completely surrender at the lotus feet of Krishna, but in our material day-to-day life, Maharaj, there are several situations, some special cases, some non-special cases. Every moment, Maharaj, how do I understand whether I am doing something in a surrendered mood or not? Because a lot of times, in a certain situation, I lose my patience, I lose tolerance, I react, and I understand that I'm not surrendering because I am reacting. And a lot of situations, Maharaj, maybe there is a need that I need to speak up to ensure that bhakti, the process of bhakti remains safe in its place to an extent. So Maharaj, how can I practice surrender? What is the way that I can constantly, every moment,
I remain surrendered every moment is to think, how can I serve Krishna at this particular moment? How can I serve the Lord now? What is my service? Just like you're sitting here, your service is to hear. My service is to speak, that is surrender. So that's the movement. The devotee is thinking, how can I serve at every moment? And if there's no practical service you can do, you can always chant. You can always remember Krishna. you can always read the book. So there's always some way to do some service. And then it won't be either active or something less active. So if you're thinking like that, that's bhakti. That's how Prabhupada taught us to teach that. Every minute in glory, you should be thinking, how can I serve? And if you're engaged in service, you're doing it. And then when that service ends, and you think, okay. But when you practice that, then it becomes natural. And when you don't, when you're not serving, you feel unhappy. You look for service. So that's the move. How can I serve now? Every minute. If you meditate on that, it actually becomes part of you for a while, after a while. Then you'll, and Krishna will help you. When you develop that will, he'll give you the intelligence of what to do or how to do it. He will help you. He gives you the knowledge. Oh, this person wants to serve. Okay. So he's in your heart and he'll tell you.
So a lot of times, Maharaj, in a particular situation, maybe there is a voice coming from my heart, but I still am not able to control myself and follow the voice that I'm hearing. And I know something that is not what I hear. So Maharaj, in such a situation, how do I control myself and not do it in such a situation?
Are you sure what you're hearing is correct? The reason why you're not doing it is because either two things, you're not sure it's correct, or you want to do something else. Either one. Otherwise, that's not strong enough. So your desire to do something else may be stronger than that voice that's coming. And the question is, what is the voice? What is it saying? If it's saying something devotional, then you should follow it. If it's saying something material, then there's no need to follow it. But if it's saying something that looks devotional, but it's material, that's another thing. Then you have to think about that. Is this going to be good for me or not? Is this what I really should be doing? Yeah. I mean, we have to be a little reflective and introspective. We shouldn't just simply react to every situation. But the thing is, Maya is always there to trick us.
So someone just asked a question about service attitude, but how do we develop that service attitude?
Yeah, we mentioned that by associating with devotees. And the association of devotees, that's what goes on with the movement of service. Of course, we develop friendships and we exchange ideas conversations, but ultimately devotional devotee service association means service. How can I serve the devotees? How can I serve this devotee? Association.
One last question, Maharaj. Sometimes we're not in the devotee association, but perhaps that devotee looks like a devotee, but in their heart, because we've been associated with them, we can tell that somewhere something's like not right about that devotee, some intentions may not be right for the reason they're practicing or devotional service. So, what can we do in that situation?
You're in association with someone who is not serious. Give him some prasad. We don't go around instructing people, that's the general thing we don't do that. Unless we're in a position to do that. But being friendly is nice. Just being friendly with the devotee, sitting down and taking prasad together. Or if you feel like you don't want to associate with that, move on. You don't have to. No one's forcing you to associate with someone you do you don't want. Generally, we look for association with people who are more like by nature, or like-minded. They say that in marriage and in friendship, like-mindedness is important. Before you get married, make sure your husband and your wife are on the same page. I didn't know how I'm starting to say that.
Thank you, Maharaj. So, give us a lady and we'll stop here. Maharaj here for the next 3 days, not that this is the last class. And he has also to be in the past.
Well, coming up to lunch time, right?
So today, Maharaj is actually having kirtan in the class. So it's kirtan plus class. So 6 to 7 is prasad and 7 o'clock to 9 o'clock. So kirtan
plus class. So 7 to 9?
7.
Okay. 2 hours of kirtan, right? Okay. Bring all the kirtan eaters. All the ones that like to play, when can sing and love to play the renowners. Everyone should come, of course.
So I love you to please come again in the evening. And, we announce 6 to 9 kirtan. I have a fear, past couple of occasions, my devotees didn't show up on time. The best thing is 6 to 7 is prasad and the 7 to 9 is kirtan.
So we'll do the Sunday feast and then we'll do something in the evening.
Yes.
Two things tomorrow's good, not on the top. Because I think I need that time to be chanting.
Yes.
It's a little too. Yeah. I killed the Swami and he also needs to chant too.
Thank you for coming
and doing your association. Hare Krishna. Well, come tonight, and we'll kirtan is our life, so we'll have some nice kirtan. Hare Krishna.